Hello everyone. In this video, I am going to tell you about occlusal equilibration in the posterior teeth, in centric and in eccentric contacts. So let's start with the definition of occlusal equilibration. The reshaping of occlusal surface of the teeth to create harmonious contacts between the maxillary and the mandibular teeth. This involves the reduction of either cusp or central fossa or sometimes both. Now let's see the different types of cusps on a tooth. Now let's first start with the supporting or working or holding cusps. These support the vertical dimension of face by forming the occlusal stops. As you can see in this picture, the maxillary, palatal and mandibular buccal cusps are the supporting cusps. The guiding or balancing or non-working cusps guide the movement of mandible during function. They do not form any occlusal stop, that is, they don't occlude with opposing tooth. The maxillary buccal and the mandibular lingual cusps are guiding cusps. The central fossa forms the occlusal stops for supporting cusp of opposing teeth. Now let me tell you about the working and non-working side contacts. First, the working side contact. This is also known as the laterotrusive contact. This is the contact on the side towards which the mandible moves from the centric occlusion. For example, now let's say if you move your mandible towards the right side. Now the occlusion or the occlusal contact on the right side is known as the working contact. Whereas the contact on the left side in the same movement is known as the non-working side movement. Now in this picture you can see the working side contact and the mandibular tooth has moved buccally with respect to the maxilla. In this position, the occlusal contact is between the opposing supporting and guiding cusps so that the upper supporting contacts the lower guiding and the lower guiding contacts the upper supporting. Now blue arrow in this picture are supporting cusps and black dots are guiding cusps. Non-working contacts or mediotrusive contacts are contacts on the side away from which the mandible has moved from the centric occlusion. Now as I have already told you, when you move your mandible towards right, the contact on the left side is the non-working and the contact on the right side is working. Now remember, normally there is no occlusal contact on non-working side in a natural dentition. When present, these are the most damaging contacts. So if a non-working contact is present in a natural dentition, it should be removed as early as possible. In a complete denture or in a distal extension RPD case, the non-working contacts are present and are important and are often called the balancing contacts. The mandibular tooth in non-working movement, it moves lingually with respect to the maxillary tooth and the opposing supporting cusps are in contact. That is, the upper palatal contacts the lower buccal cusp. Now let's start with the equilibration part. The occlusal prematurities can be seen in any of the three positions, that is in centric, in working side contact or in non-working side contact. A few points that you must remember are, first, always check in the centric position before you start with the occlusal equilibration. Second, try to preserve the occlusal contacts in the centric and eccentric positions. The third point that you must remember is that the occlusal contact involved in prematurities in various positions are supporting cusp, guiding cusp and central fossa. So either of these or more than one of these may be reduced when we are reducing the centric or eccentric prematurities. Now let's go to the occlusal equilibration in centric occlusion position. The black shaded area represents the possible prematurity and the contact in this position is between the supporting cusps and the central fossa. So if you reduce the supporting cusp here, it would relieve the interference in the centric, but it would lead to opening of contacts in working and non-working positions. So reduction of supporting cusp in centric is not recommended. So the only option left is to reduce the central fossa. Now when you reduce the central fossa, it relieves the interference in centric, and since the central fossa does not participate in either working or non-working contacts, it does not have any effect on these positions. So in centric interference, reduce the central fossa. Now let's see the working side interference. Now as I have already explained, in working side interference, the contact is seen between the opposing supporting and guiding cusps. The arrows represent the supporting and the dot represents the guiding cusp. The shaded area again represents the possible site of interference. The question now is, how do we reduce this interference? Now we can either reduce the supporting cusp or the guiding cusp. Let's see what happens when we reduce the supporting cusps. The interference in working contact is reduced, but it leads to opening of contact in both centric and non-working contacts. So let's instead reduce the guiding cusps. Now, when you reduce the guiding cusp, this would again reduce the or remove the interference in the working side contact. And since the guiding cusps do not participate in occlusion in either centric or in non-working contact, so these positions are not affected. Here you will notice that the upper guiding cusp is buccal, that is buccal upper, and the lower guiding cusp is lingual, that is lower lingual. Now when you write this together, you will get BU, that is buccal upper, and LL, that is lower lingual. So this becomes the Bull's law. And according to the Bull's law, in working side interference, you must reduce the upper buccal and the lower lingual. Now let's see the non-working side interference. As you know, the contact is between the upper and the lower supporting cusps. So to reduce the interference, we either reduce one or both of these cusps. Now when you reduce both these cusps, the contact, that is the occlusal contact in both centric and in working will be completely open. That is, there will be no contact in either working or in centric. Now this must be prevented. So what we do instead is that we reduce either of these supporting cusps. Now either you can reduce the upper supporting or the lower supporting. This would partially maintain the occlusal contact in both centric and in working. So this is still acceptable. So you can reduce either the upper lingual or the lower buccal cusp. Here you would notice that the cusps to be reduced have reversed from the working interference. That is, in working interference, we reduce buccal upper, lower lingual. But here we would reduce either upper lingual or lower buccal. So this, in this non-working side contact, becomes the reverse Bull's law. That is upper lingual, lower buccal. This is the reverse Bull's law. So to sum it up, in centric interference, reduce the central fossa. In working side interference, reduce the guiding cusps, that is the upper buccal, lower lingual, or you can say the Bull's law. In non-working contact, you must reduce one of the two supporting cusps, that is either the upper lingual or the lower buccal, and this becomes the reverse Bull's law. That's all for now, friends. I hope this video was helpful, and if you do find it helpful, please like, comment and share, and please don't forget to subscribe. Thank you.